start by asking you about the idea of common security clubs. What kind of thought process went into coming up with this?
I think they came about out of a need. And if you think back a year ago, how people were feeling about the economic crisis and the level of anxiety and fear. So it was a recognition that people needed places to come together to talk about how the economic crisis was affecting them personally and to look at ways to help one another and do things that none of us could do alone. So the thinking was, let's not be isolated. Let's not try to figure it out in the privacy of our own home, but come together.
Not have the assumption that I know everything. I don't need help and I can't get help.
Well, in fact, I think one of the things that happened a year ago is a lot of us were caught by surprise. We realized that the experts had gotten it wrong, that maybe we hadn't been paying attention. The housing market's going to go up forever. You can borrow against your home and purchase things. And, you know, there was a sort of sense, there was a big wake-up call, I think. So I think part of the value of coming together is let's learn about what's happening in the economy, talk to our neighbors, and take responsibility for, you know, not giving our power to the experts, but making judgments for ourselves.
Now, dozens of common security clubs have formed in churches and other organizations. What exactly does a common security club do?
Most of them, and there's several hundred around the country, are groups of 15 to 20 adults. Maybe they commit to meet together five or six times initially and go through a process, and we've sort of developed some materials to help them start. But they have three basic purposes: learn together, mutual aid, and social action. And by learn together, I mean reading, understanding the changing economy, watching videos, reading articles, just following things, events in the news, things that, in a sense, we weren't paying attention to, and now we need to pay attention as citizens. So learning together. Mutual aid is helping one another out. It could be making a pact to get out of debt. It could be helping a member of the club help find work. It's helping weatherize each other's homes. There's a sort of self-help, mutual aid part of this. What are things that you have to offer? What are things I need? How can we maybe help each other exchange? And then social action is recognizing we can't be a bank to each other. We can't be a healthcare system. We can't be a job program. There's things we maybe can come together for and advocate at the local and state and even at the federal level to make the economy work better for everybody. So those are the three purposes, and each club meeting has some component of all of it.
As the common security clubs have formed and sort of gone through this process, has there been some sort of a predominant theme that's developed or some sort of kind of direction they've seemed to start heading?
Well, I think that most of them just value the community building. I mean, the reality is one out of four adults in this country have no one they can turn to and talk about their most intimate concerns. And another one out of four have only one person. So there's a lot of people who are socially isolated. They might be sitting in the pews of this church and they might know one another, but they're not in relationship. So, you know, in some ways, that's the core, is people coming together, helping one another. It's, in some ways, I mean, new immigrants have done it, and our ancestors did it when they first came to this country. They had to pull together to help one another out. And we've gotten out of practice. So I think that's the other theme, is we need to get back in shape, if you will. Our mutual aid muscles are a little out of shape. We don't know how to help one another in the way that others have done over the years. And that's one of the, you know, here we are in New England, you know, we're tough, independent Yankees. We really pride ourselves in self-sufficiency and figuring things out. But there were also, you know, under that self-sufficiency, there were a lot of institutions and mutual aid networks and religious congregations did a lot to kind of hold each other together.
So you're talking about something beyond building up a food pantry.
Well, yeah, I think that the economy is going through major changes. I mean, we are seeing, even though there are sort of these signs that the stock market is up and, you know, public investment is happening, there's deep unemployment trends that aren't going to go away anytime soon. We're going to have a so-called recovery without any increase in, well, while unemployment keeps rising. We can't have an economy based on borrowing, which is what we were doing for the last 15, 30 years, you know. Most of the economic growth was driven by people borrowing on credit cards, borrowing against their homes. That's not a healthy economy.
Now, you've just said something, though, that in today's world is pretty radical. Every small business borrows to grow. Everybody borrows to buy a home. How, you're advocating completely changing that thinking, and is it realistic to do so?
I'm not sure if I'm saying change the thinking. I'm thinking part of what some of the common security clubs, they call themselves sort of reality support groups. What do we know to be real, right, that's happening in the economy? So the reality is local businesses, local enterprise, food industries, real goods and services, that's the real economy. In each of our communities, there's a real economy we can point to and celebrate. What happened in the last 20 years is the growth of what I would call kind of the phantom economy that was based on debt and kind of a paper wealth. You know, the increase in home values wasn't really based on anything real in the economy. So the bubble burst, right, in the housing market. $10 trillion in housing wealth evaporated. Well, a lot of people were able to sustain their standard of living by borrowing on that phantom wealth. We all were. A lot of us were involved in our standard of living based on what the president called illusory wealth. So I don't know if it's changing that so much as just going back to what we know to be true and real in the economy, and living within our means, and engaging in economic activity that we can see and understand, as opposed to sort of economic activity that I would call sort of phantom wealth creation. So I think that's, and if you watch the news every day, it's go out and buy, everything's fine, things are going back to normal. But if you really read the signs of the times, what's happening to real wages, what's happening to jobs, what's happening to people's ability to save, what is the economy of the future really going to look like in Maine and New Hampshire and Vermont? We need to have a reality-based discussion of what the future looks like. So in a way, a common security club is like the place where you come and talk about how do we prepare ourselves for the future.
Do you believe that this recession is an opportunity in some ways?
Well, it clearly was a wake-up call for a lot of us to take a real look at our budgets, to take a look at our jobs and what part of our job is going to be tied to something in the future economy. It got us thinking, many of us thinking locally again, about how do we purchase our goods and services locally. I think in one way, though, I think we're going back to sleep, because I think there's a way in which the stock market going up and some of the sort of stories about what's happening in the economy have lulled us back into thinking, oh, we're going to somehow be able to go back to the good old days of 2006 or 1996. And the reality is we are not going back to something that we've known. We can't go back to a model of growth based on borrowing against illusory wealth. We can't go back to an economy that's based on the kinds of inequalities of wealth and opportunity that we've seen in the last 30 years.
Where would you like to see this Common Security Club movement be a year from now, 5 years from now? What would be your ideal dream of where we're going with this?
Well, I would hope that there would be thousands and thousands of people who would have a extended network of people, whether it's connected to a congregation or community, that they can depend on and rely on. And I think I'd like to see it be a part of how we strengthen our economies, how we strengthen our democracy, because we have given up a lot of power over how the economy is going to operate to Wall Street people who really don't have the best interests of our communities in mind. So part of it, I think I hope that by people learning together, helping one another out in a concrete way, we strengthen our communities, we strengthen our relationships, and we also build a little bit of power to work for an economy that helps everybody, that lifts everybody up. We've pulled apart. In the last 30 years, we've become a more unequal society, and the middle class dream, the American dream, I think is slipping away. If you look at our paychecks and the number of jobs and the number of hours people have to work, one of the things that happened a year ago, I think, was we got a wake-up call in terms of what really makes us secure. What makes us secure? And a lot of people realized it's more than money. It's more than sort of an illusory paycheck. It's the strength of our communities, the strength of our family ties and networks, as well as the strength of our regional economies. Let's make our focus that and invest in that. So I'm hoping the common security clubs are just part of a movement to help us prepare for the future in a healthy way.
Well, thank you, Chuck Collins, for joining us.
Thanks, Jennifer.